Hey guys, it's Tiny Tom Logan back with another video for you. And today I'm finally going to be reviewing the Crosshair 6 Hero. Now people did wonder why I didn't do this at the start, because a lot of people did kind of do their CPU reviews at the start. Now the problem is if I do a CPU review on a board, then I'm not going to know whether the board's any good. And I can't exactly say the board's any good if it's the first one that I've tested. So what I did is I started with one of the lower end boards, which was the X370 Prime, and I did my CPU review on that. Then I did a Gigabyte board after that, and then I moved on to this, because this is £250. The Gigabyte was 200, the X370 Prime was 150. Is this gonna be worth an extra £100 over the X370 Pro? Well, now I've actually got some meat to my graphs, and I've actually got a chance to get to know Ryzen a little better, I think it's the better time for me to be able to actually see whether this is any good. So if you're genuinely interested, go and get yourself a cup of tea, go and get yourself some biscuits, get comfortable, put your feet up, close the door to your bedroom, I don't know, give your kids some Cowpole, and yeah, get comfortable. Okay, so I've stripped a few bits out so that we can have a quick ganders around the board. Now, first things first, and it's something that a lot of people keep confusing with other boards, the Crosshair 6 is the only board that supports AM3 and AM4 coolers. It's not the actual CPU socket, because the socket is different. So if you look there, we've got the AM4 bracket on, and it's a little bit wider, but you can see underneath the other kind of holes, that's the AM3 ones. They're the ones that are a little bit longer but closer together. With the plastic off, you can see the AM4 backplate poking through, and you can see the holes there for the AM3 ones. Now, if you're going to use an AM3 cooler with this, you do need to make sure that you've got the backplate to go with it. Most coolers, if they use a backplate, will come with them, but it's just something to kind of keep in mind. Because it has been a cause of confusion that I've seen with some people. But the best thing that I can say is this is the only board at the moment I know that supports this, because I keep getting messages from people, does this motherboard support AM3 as well? And they seem to think all of them do, but this is a very unique kind of board by supporting both at the moment. Also, over time, it may become null and void, because all of the coolers now are kind of getting updated to support AM4, because there is a lot of hype around it at the moment. So it's going to be we hope that everything will eventually be covered. If you've got a cooler that you would like to reuse, then just check on the manufacturer's website to see if they're going to be updating it. Most of the Asetek coolers are now doing it. Corsair are rolling out updates. You're just going to have to go to them to ask about it. But to be honest with you, also think about, because of Ryzen is quite warm, think about if your cooler is going to be up to it. I would probably say that you need a massive air cooler or an AIO. So if you haven't already got that, rather than thinking, can I reuse my other one, I would seriously look at maybe getting something that does support AM4 or is about to support AM4. It's a real big kind of up and down moment at the moment, with everyone kind of rolling out updates. So it really is one to keep your eye on your favorite website. Hopefully that might include OC3D, my one, along some of the line, because keeping up with the updates is going to be key. So plenty of power phases around the outside of the board, making sure that we've got plenty of clean power, and the chokes and caps and MOSFETs are not gonna be getting stressed out delivering it. First batch of fan headers here. We've got our CPU optional, CPU, and then you've got the AIO header here for your all-in-one water cooling, so your H100Is and your NZXT Krakens and all that sort of stuff. But also, right down at the very bottom of the board, you also have this water pump plus header. Now, the difference between the AIO and the water pump plus header is the AIO delivers 1 amp, the water pump plus delivers 3 amps. Now, just to kind of give you an idea, when you plug something into that water pump header, it will automatically spin at 100%. So you are going to need to go into the BIOS or use the AI Suite software to tame that. but because of the extra amps these two headers can deliver, this can be actually a really nice place to plug in PWM splitters. I'm a big fan of PWM splitters now because it can keep cabling and that sort of thing down. Rather than having six fans in your case and needing six individual headers, you could actually just plug them into two. So keep that in mind, but like I said, if you do plug something in there, it will run at full speed until you sort it out, because it is set up to be a water cooling header. While we are down here though, and talking about water cooling, there is a water cooling zone just here. The two pins are actually a thermal probe, so you can have a water in and out. And then the one at the top is a water flow. So you've got some really nice kind of little things down there that you can plug into all your water cooling gubbins if you've gone full water cooling. And then that way you can keep an eye on things. You can also set it up so your system would shut down if the pump was to stop, for example. There's a lot of really cool little ideas going on down there. There's another chassis fan header there on the back of the board. One there near the front. There's another one there at the bottom, and that's also by the side of the start button, the reset button, the safe boot and the retry button. The safe boot, you can actually save a profile so that you can, when you hit that button, it will boot to your saved profile. So by safe boot, you could pick an overclock setting that you're happy with, and it's always 100%. And then when you're tweaking around, if something goes wrong, you can do that and it will go back to it. Or you can just save it with manual stock settings or something. And on the white button on the far right, that's actually a retry button. And that's, so if it looks like your overclock is hung during post, you can hit that, and it, rather than resetting it and then Windows going nuts and then eventually saying, oh, do you want to fix this? That will just clean reboot and doesn't, you know, mess around with anything to do with Windows. But if we zoom out, you can see where the buttons are. They're all down the bottom. That's it for fan headers, but it's easy to see here that you've got the M.2 slot down the bottom. That's an 80mm M.2, but it does support up to 110. You've got your two PCI Express slots. The top one is your main 16x slot. The second one you can use, but it's actually only wired for 8, and if you run two at the same time, then it's 8 and 8, and that's all coming from the CPU. But you do have these extra PCI Express 2, because these are PCI Express 3. This one, and this one, and this one are PCI Express 2, and they take their lanes from here. You can't put three graphics cards in and run them in crossfire. You can put three graphics cards in. Technically, you can 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. You can put 6 in there if you really wanted to, but they you can't crossfire them or anything like that. These are the two main, we'll call them gaming slots. And this is your first port card. This is where you should put your graphics card. If you put it in here, it's actually only wired for 8 times, so the pins stop halfway along. So that's just something to keep in mind as well. Lovely design around the heat sinks, and I'll show you it lit up when we put all the rest of the bits back in the board. But you do get 8 SATAs down the side. Just here, there is a USB 3.1 header. So there is a USB 3 down at the bottom here, but there's no obvious USB 2. Now, I'm using the far right-hand side of the ROG extension header here, and you can use the far right side as a USB 2. So there's a little hint for you. It doesn't look like it necessarily has one, but you can do. If you need more than one port, you can buy USB 2 hubs that you can put in your case. You plug one in here like this, and then it gives you like 3 or 4 internal USB 2s. Even I keep them in for stuff now. So if you haven't got one, for the sake of 20 quid, if you've got AIOs and you've got power supplies with those kind of connections, it's worth just getting one, even if you just chuck it in your man drawer and you only use it a couple of 3 times a year. But it's definitely handy to have, and you can get them from a range of brands, but the ones I've been using are NZXT, and they're actually quite handy, and they're magnetic and stuff, so it's all rather good. If you're interested in tweaking as well, hidden behind the 24-pin connect cable, because once you've got your case in there, it's going to be very hard to see it. Once you've got your cable in there, sorry, it's very hard to see it. But there we go. There are the pick-out points for using a digital multimeter on there. That's specifically handy if you want to check like your V-core and make sure that the software's, you know, accurate and all that kind of thing. So that's one for the overclocking boys. It can be a bit annoying trying to get to it if you have got a cable on it. But I'm going to assume that if you're actually going to want that, you're likely to be using it on a test bench anyway. So then you can just, for want of a better term, you can wrap your cable from the top or something, or hold it out the way. But it's just, it's quite a busy board, so it's probably better that you have it rather than don't have it. And like I said, it's there if you really need it, but very few people are going to, although I've been playing with it this time. When we come around the back, there is absolutely stacks and stacks of USB. There is also BIOS flashback on the back. So you can see clear CMOS is this button. This one is BIOS flashback, and you put it in there. Don't forget, with BIOS flashback, if you do want to use it and you're thinking to yourself, well, it's not working, you do have to, if you're using it with an updated BIOS, you do have to change the name of the file. If you look on the driver CD, you'll see there's a BIOS file in there. Just change your most recent updated one so it's got the same name, and then BIOS flashback works. Happy hint for you there, but it's something that does still come up in comments when people have been tripped up by it. Well, we've got USB 3.1 down here, and we've got a C and an A connection, gigabit Ethernet. We've got 8 USB 3s, that's loads. It's most I've seen on a board for such a long time. And then you've got a fair load of USB 2s there, including this one, which supports the keybot, and that's that really handy bit of software. So you can set like F buttons and stuff on your keyboard to actually be macros or open certain programs. And that's something that comes on the driver CD. And then you've got your audio out down here. There are little gold plated connectors on the inside, and you have your SPDIF there if you want it as well. Couple other things just to point out, just really quickly, you've got an RGB header down here on this bit. I'm not going to zoom you in or out for it. There's another one here as well, so if you do end up using one of the RGB standard coolers, then from AMD with one of the lower end processors, then your header is here for it. You do have a PCI out up here as well, so that you can monitor your postcodes and because we're going to be sending letters. But that's also so if you get hangs and stuff when you're overclocking, that you can fault find. And if you go into the manual that comes in the box, you'll find a list of what all those numbers mean. And it's really weird once you've been staring at them as long as I do. When they come up, you're like, oh, it's that. And yes, far too nerdy, but you might enjoy it. It's a good read. Handy hint, if your cooler uses the standard bracket and then little pull tabs, basically. So basically, if your cooler uses the standard AMD bracket to mount, and you just get the hardware with the actual cooler itself to allow it to fit to the standard mounts on the motherboard, then they are no different to the old AMD one. So this cooler, mount is for AM3 basically, but it fits. It's only if your cooler needs to bolt through the board or has its own back plate or something like that, you do need to be careful about the AM4 fitment, because the holes are slightly different. Now, this is more of something for other boards, in case we've got enthusiasts watching this video that are, you know, just watching it because it's the Crosshair 6 video. So if you think about buying another board, it's only the ones that go through the board that you have to go careful with. Obviously, with the Crosshair 6, it supports pretty much everything, so you don't need to worry too much. But that is just a very simple rule of thumb for other boards. If it fits like this, then you have nothing to worry about. Your old cooler will work. Even if you're buying a new old cooler, it will work. If it's one of the ones that goes through the board, you just need to go and have a look on the cooler manufacturer's website, or keep your eye on the news and stuff, because they do seem to be all rolling out updates. There doesn't seem to be a great deal of stock at the moment, but they are all trying to get it sorted and get them out to the public as quick as possible. Even I'm waiting to get some for things like Cryo Rig and stuff. So and the Corsair ones as well, I'm waiting for those. But they are coming, it's just when they start arriving, really. So let's hope it's sorted in the next couple of weeks. So the RGB on the boards is confined to two places. Here on the chipset, and the little cutout on the chipset is a masterstroke, because it does give a really nice little kind of shadow and depth to it. It doesn't show up too much on the camera because of the fact that, you know, the camera's spazzing out because of the light. But to the naked eye, you do get some really subtle shadows. You can see it all goes underneath as well. It's that I personally really, really like this look. But don't forget, you can change all the colours yourself. And if you don't like it, you can turn them off, which is even better if you're, you know, not that way inclined. It's also up here on the kind of rear IO, the writing up here that I'm kind of blocking up, that says Crosshair 6. You've got a little cutout underneath and it gives it a nice little bit of light across the top. You do also get a bit of bleed through up here onto the actual heatsink itself. And again, it's subtle, but it is quite nice. So when the rest of your rig is on and everything is running, it does all of a sudden get quite subtle and look really nice. Okay, so a skim around the BIOS, and it's an overclocking board, so we do need to have a look at the BIOS. So this is your main section where you come in, where you see stuff. You can see we're running the 1800X because I'm going to be using the 1800X on all of my motherboard reviews. Extreme Tweaker, this is where the fun happens really. When you do start to make changes, the yellow are the things that you really want to keep your eyes on, because as you start changing certain aspects, they will update so you'll know what's changed. Now, when you come down to overclock tuner here, there are a lot of options in it. We're used to auto, manual and XMP, but obviously we don't get XMP on the AMD stuff, we get DOCP. Now down here we can see we've got a lot of options for DOCP. Now DOCP is like XMP and it will auto set up your memory for you so it will run at rated. Now at the moment with the AMD stuff, the BIOS is horrifically picky. Now this is across the all brands, because basically what happens is AMD have to set up certain things with the memory and then hand the motherboard manufacturers the code to put in the BIOS so that then the BIOS will pick up the memory properly. Some memory will not work at all, as in it will not post. It will look like something is broken. That could be the memory. Some memory will boot fine and run at 2133, but when you try and enable DOCP, it won't work and it looks like something's broken. So there are a lot of kind of hit and miss things at the moment. So the best thing that you can do, especially in the early days, is keep an eye on the QVL lists. Although the QVL lists are being updated quite rapidly. Now with this, you can see that we've got DOCP1 loads the optimal settings for the system. Now this is DOCP1. And this is going to load whatever the memory tells it to, what would have been like the XMP. And then you've got down here 2133, 2400, 26, 29, 33. So it can try and kind of auto overclock for you. Now, one thing that you do need to remember, some people are going, oh, look, it's 2933, it's not 3000. Well, there isn't a direct tie-in from the 100 base clock to 3000 with the AMD setup. If we go down here to memory frequency, you can see these are the memory frequency settings that we have available to us. Now, this is the stock AMD stuff. But just to make things more confusing now, on this board, unlike the other ones that I've tested so far, if you go to manual, then you do actually get a base clock frequency as well. So it's 100 at standard. So if we plumb 100 in, it's that. But then if we keep an eye on this, if I was to go 110, oh, that's too many ones, 110, you can see that we're starting to eke our way up. But it will auto also change the divider, because that's the other complicated thing. So if I turn it back to auto, what we can do is go down to CPU ratio. Now I'm going to set it to 36, because that's stock, 3600 megahertz. So we set it to 36. And then if we go back up to base clock frequency, 100 in, and then you see it's not changed. 110 though, oh, 110. If I change that, you can see instantly that's gone up to 3.9 gigahertz. Go back down to 105, so we'll half it. You can see it's gone from 3.6 up to 3.78. But also, you can see that the memory timings will change as well. So just to kind of run you through it just quickly, we'll set that to 100, we've got that stock, and then what we're going to do is we're going to go down to memory frequency and we're going to set it to 2666. So you can see the memory has now changed to 2666. Then if we go back up here, change that to just 101, you can see that your 2666 is now almost 27 and you've got a little bit on the memory. We go up a big step though, and you can see that from 2666 memory in 3.6 gigahertz, just by changing that to 110, we've now got 3.96 and then 2933, and we can go up a little bit further, 112, 113, there we go, 113, so 112.5. So we're almost at 3000 megahertz there. So there are ways that you can get your 3000 megahertz in, but it's a lot more hands-on than you may have been used to with other platforms. AMD has always been a little bit more hands-on. We've not actually got the NB frequencies or the NBHT. There used to be a lot more things that we could tweak. Now again, so I'm just going to F5 this, so loads optimized default, so we're back to normal. The other thing that you can do is there is CPU core ratio, hang on, let's look at that one there. You can go to manual and it brings up the FID and the DID, and it's a multiplier and then a frequency divisor, so you can actually go about changing your multiplier with these as well. So I'm not going to go through everything with you. There are a lot of things that you can play with this board, is basically what I'm going to say. Now, when we get down to the bottom, we've got CPU core voltage, CPU SoC. The SoC can help with memory when you're running high-speed memory. Don't touch this willy-nilly, though. And then you've got your DRAM voltages, and then you've got your PLL and your Southbridge voltage. And also in the extreme tweakers, you've got your load line calibration, current capability, power duty control, phase control, all the normal stuff that you would have been used to with the other boards. In advanced, ROG effects is your onboard LED. So this is a really easy way without the software that you can disable it. On some of the other boards, you used to actually be able to come in here and change the colors manually as well. I would like to see this be updated, because on the other ROG ranges in here you can do. So this would be great, because then you don't have to change the software. If you just want to set it to red or blue or green, this like the Intel boards from Asus, you can do it in here. So they need to get that added. But again, it's quite an early BIOS. And then with monitor, you've got all of your settings. Like for argument's sake, here I said to you about the in and the out temperatures on the water cooling before. So you can see your water in temperature, water out temperature if we had them connected. And also the flow speed if we had that connected as well. And then in the QFan configuration, if you don't want to add in the software, you can come into QFan tuning. You can set a slow up and slow down time. This is how quickly your fans get quicker or slow down again. You can set the fan limits as well, but also, really simple, if you don't want to run software and set custom fan profiles, you can come in here and turn them on to silent if you want a quiet rig, or you can go on to turbo if you want a, you know, like it going real mental. But you can also go to manual and literally sit in here for days tweaking your minimums and your lower end and all of that sort of stuff. So you can have quite a bit of fun with that. But you need to remember that you're going to be going in and out of your operating system all the time to get this set up and tuned. When you do set them, run something like your favorite game or OCCT to stress the CPU, or like Cinebench or something. Also, mentioning Cinebench, I've just realized that I forgot something. If you are benchmarking, then what you can do is up the top here, there is a performance bias that you can hit here. And you've got Cinebench 15, IDA and Geekbench runs, and Cinebench 11.5. You can enable that, and it will give you a little bit of a performance boost, or, you know, tunes things to favor those benchmarks. So if you are benchmarking and you're trying to get the absolute best scores, this is a good place to go. But you don't really need to worry about it for normal kind of desktop or gaming use. Beyond that, the only other things that we've got in here, you can set up your boot. I'm going the wrong way. You can set up all your boot stuff. In the tools, you've got the overclocking profile, which is something that I always play around with. And then ROG overclock key configure, because you can get those external things that you can use that are just, yes. And then Asus SPID, so you can go through and look at your memory. And then graphics card information in there as well. So I've shown you that there's a lot of extra stuff in the BIOS. Definitely, I've only reviewed two other boards, and that's the X370 Prime and the Gigabyte Gaming 5. Now, there's a lot more in the BIOS than this than there was with those other boards. You had all of those extra DOCP settings, and then the biggest thing that the massive difference was being able to change the base clock. With the other boards, it was just locked at 100. But did it really make a lot of difference? I mean, with the old AMDs, we used to be able to easily get a 200 base clock, and I've seen some of the older sort of pile drivers and bulldozers. I think it was pile driver, I got to like 350. So there was a lot of tweaking there. There's sadly not with Ryzen. But where this is the first time I've actually had a proper hands-on and been able to play with it, it was fairly new ground for me. Now, there are apparently going to be BIOSes that will increase the base clock ability, but the most I managed to get was 135. Now, it was 135, but that was with a very, very low multiplier, because you drop the multiplier right down so that you know that you find the limit of the actual BCLK ability, and then you try and mix it in with some base clock as well. Now, when I did that, I did need to drop it right back to 125, but with 125 base clock, I did manage to get just over 4.2 gigahertz. It was pretty stable. If you were just gaming and doing the odd bit of stuff here and there, you'd probably never notice. But with some incredibly stressful stuff, so like the X265 benchmark was one of them, one of the Sandras genuinely tripped it up as well. Amazingly, OCCT was, it never seemed to fail on the same moment, but it was the benchmarks that you noticed, you know the ones to go to. Anyway, so it wasn't 100% stable at that. The volts were a little bit high as well, but the other thing was, it was the load line calibration was kind of doing its own thing and putting the volts up. Also, and this is something that is, it's an AMD thing and not an ASUS thing, the volts all work on a offset and like a VID offset. So you can kind of put your volts in at like 1.45 and then it can still go up a bit as well in the normal settings. Apparently in the very latest BIOS, which I've not got, but I know there's a version coming, in the extreme tweakers section, there's going to be a section where you can put the voltage in for your CPU and it won't go above it. Whereas at the moment it auto does. And that is a weird setting with AMD. I'm hoping all the motherboard manufacturers will sort it, because they all do it. It's not this board. So that was one of the reasons why, with the screenshot that I brought up then, it was showing 1.5 volts, where it's actually a lot lower in the BIOS, and it was just kind of doing that itself. There are still some kind of weird, glitchy things going on with the boards and the BIOS, and part of the reasoning behind that is the initial CPUs that went out to the motherboard manufacturers and SIs and stuff like that, they were much, much worse than the actual retail ones and the ones that we were sent for review. The early ones were terrible, really, is probably the best way that I can put it. So it was only when the more recent chips that come out that were going to go out, basically the retail ones, and the motherboard manufacturers had about 2 to 3 weeks to try and get BIOS out. The other thing that you're probably unaware of as well is, whereas before with Intel, you would get loads of memory in and you would QVL it for yourself and then sort it out with your own BIOS. But with the AMD boards, and again, this is with all of the brands, what they are having to do, they're relying on AMD doing the memory profiling, because they have to get some code which can then be put into the BIOS, and that's how the memory works. That's also why there isn't a massive amount of memory compatibility at the moment. Just so that you're aware, if you're watching this or someone's linked it to you because I've spoken about it, the way it works is you can get some memory that literally you put it in and it doesn't work at all. As in, it will look like something's broken and it won't post. That could be your memory. The other one is it will boot up and it'll run fine. This is for the most part of it at the moment. It'll boot up and it'll run fine and it'll look like it's running at 2133. But the second you try and enable DOCP to get the memory running at rated, that is when you run into problems then. And that's for sort of the lower speed memory. I mean, I've got a 2666 kit that won't run for love nor money. And then I can put a 3000 kit in and it starts up straight away. So it's all a bit kind of weird at the moment. One thing I will say though, is if you're having problems with your higher speed memory, so above 2666, say you're trying to get 2933 or 3200 running, and you've got a kit that you know is on the QVL list, one of the things I can say is give the SoC volt a little bit of a tickle. Do not go above 1.2. Do not just put 1.2 in straight away. Work your way up. So 1.1, 1.2, 1.4, and wait till you get to a stable point. Because adding SoC volts in will increase your temperatures, and that's obviously something that we don't want to be doing with Ryzen because of how bad the cooling and everything works. I personally think now that the reason why Ryzen is a bit hot is because they've just been a little bit too aggressive with trying to make it really, really small. So we're struggling to cool it in that sense. I don't know, I could be wrong, but anyway, that's another kind of little hint guide that you can try. If you get stuck though, and this is the most important thing, is asking me in the comments. It's really difficult for me to try and be able to follow. So if you need some help and you want some answers, the best place to go is the OC3D forums, and I will try and help you there. Just please don't expect me to just sit there and chat with you for 3 hours straight. I do have to kind of dip in and out when I'm doing other things in between filming and the like, because I've actually just been helping someone just a minute ago. So anyway, there's lots of other members there and we can help. So we've got that. Then essentially what I then did is we then, 4.2 wasn't doable, so we dropped it back. Now you need to remember with the multipliers, it's not 41, 42, 43, 44. We're back in the kind of older days where there were times when you had like half a multiplier. Well, with AMD, there are quarters. So we went from, with the 4.2, it was times 33.75. With our final clock, what we ended up doing was 125 base clock times 32.75. And that gave us just under 4.1 gigahertz. But we did have 3,333 megahertz running. Yes, that's right. We've gone above 3.2. Now I showed you in the BIOS, 3.2 gigahertz for the memory, 3,200 megahertz was the last stop in that memory divider for options that we could select. Well, because we then used the base clock, we then that elongated things, which meant we could run a little bit higher. And we got it running and it was 100% stable. Now, the other thing to remember is sometimes with the other platforms, when you push memory too far on a CPU, the bandwidth drops because scores will eventually drop. It will perform like it's stable, but when you actually benchmark it, you do get to a point where it drops off. On X99, for example, once you push past 32 and sometimes 3300 megahertz, the scores can then, unless it's absolutely an epic bit of silicon, sort of silicon lottery winning stuff, or you're incredibly clever at setting it up, then the scores do start to drop off and tail right off again. For argument's sake, I've tested boards in the past where at 3200 you'd have 60,000 points in IDA, and then you go up to 3333 and you're at 44,000 points because it's all just gone wibble. So you do have to consider that. But with this, it was totally, I'm just looking for my graph, it was absolutely stable and it absolutely loved it as well. To the point where when we bring the graph up, you can see that the Prime Pro and all the stock stuff, we're doing the memory at 2666. That is our, and we literally just go in 2666 memory and we run tests, because we need a stock to be able to tell, you know, if there's any BIOS optimizations that might need doing and all that sort of stuff. So the stock stuff across all of them is actually fairly level, but the overclock is where a strong board can find its own, because it's all going to be down to how hard we can overclock it, how fast we can get the memory to go. And you can see here with the memory overclock at 3333, it's had a very healthy boost. The one below it with the gigabyte, that was 3200 megahertz. So you can see, working your way up, the Prime Pro overclock, at that point with the memory issues at launch, we were only managing to get 2933. So you can see there is a good way that the graphs work up with that higher speed memory. So they do like it as well. And keep that in mind when we get to the gaming bit. Oh, we might as well just do gaming next. The most important one with this to look at it is the Gears of War CPU render. Because let's face it, this is a CPU review. We're not going to kind of dig in too much with gaming at the moment, because in all honesty, there's not a massive amount of, going to be a massive amount of difference between specific CPUs, because this review is between the motherboards of the AM4 socket, not looking at other CPUs and other platforms and all that sort of stuff. But most important thing here is that Gears of War CPU render, and you can see that there's a fairly big difference at the top, and that is with the overclocks that have gone up, because the Prime overclock was 4 gig, and then the Gigabyte was 4.1. But the Acer sticks out at the top. And the only difference there with this one is memory. So I'm actually going to be, once the memory stuff settles down, I'm going to look into it, because this could be one where memory does start to play a big difference with gaming performance. But it's not going to be something I'm going to know about until I literally sit down and go through it all. But if nothing else, that graph is a very early indicator, considering the only big change there, because the Gigabyte was running at 4.1, 100 base clock with a 41 multiplier, and then the Asus was running just below 4.1, but with base clock and quicker memory, and you can see the big difference there. So that's actually going to be something to look forward to testing as things start to mature. Now, I'm not going to do it too soon, because I do have other boards that I need to get tested, and AMD are now starting to send me extra CPUs, not 1800Xs, we've now got the 1700 and the 1700X in. But I'm having to pick the order I do stuff in at the moment to make sure I get it all done. Anyway, when you go on to PC Mark 8, to be honest with you, that graph, I did it just to show you that some things, there really isn't a great deal of difference between any of them. When we move on to Cinebench, you can see that there is a fairly decent increment up there with Grunt. But what we can also see at the top between the Gigabyte and the Asus is that the memory hasn't made a great deal of difference. So that's all down to the actual core speed that's going on there. The other thing is that because they're the same, you can tell that the base clock doesn't really make a great deal of difference. But, because that was a rendering one, and then we get on to something else. So 3D rendering, we didn't really see much difference, but then we move on to X265. It's a transcoder, it's the X265 benchmark, so high res 4K HVEC, that sort of thing. And you can see that there's a big difference in this between the Gigabyte and the Asus. It's a fairly big step there. It's almost a step from going from a stock up to an overclock again. So there's a big difference in that graph at the top. And again, the only thing that I can think about that's really there is it either really likes base clock or the memory or a bit of both. Now, if you're interested in any more, we've done a lot of other tests on the OC3D website. There's like 20 odd pages there. We do a lot more benchmarks. There are a lot more graphs. Obviously, where it's a motherboard review, we've only got the ones that we've done so far. So you've got the X370 Prime, which is the board that I tested the 1800X on in the first place. It's also going to be the board I'm going to test all the CPUs on as well. So it's a nice kind of entry level. Then I did the Gigabyte, we're now on the Crosshair 5, and I'm just going to be adding more and more stuff into those graphs, because I don't just do standoffs. I'm a reviewer, I don't just build a rig, I actually want to test it. I'm interested in the numbers that get pumped out of it. Anyway, so, right, on to the conclusion. I like this walking around on this side of the table. Anyway, on to the conclusion. Enthusiast Award, and I'll tell you why. It's because there is a lot more that you can tweak there. People are going to shout about the price because it is £250. But there is it's the one for the people that want to play with stuff. If you just want to build a rig and you just want a game, it's probably not the one for you. It's got some nice bits and bobs on it, yeah, sure. But for £250, it's going to be difficult for those of you that literally just do want to fit and forget. It's going to be a difficult one to sell you. But if it's going to be something for someone that wants to play or is looking to base a project around something, maybe water cooling because of the water cooling header, and you want to know the temperatures that go in your rad and out of your rad or something like that, although when you do use that, think about cables. Don't just chuck it in there and have spaghetti kind of junction going on inside. You are going to, the more you add in, the more you've got to work on your cables to keep it tidy. There's not too much light on the board, which is going to be a bit hit and miss. Some other boards are like Christmas trees. This is actually kind of subtle. I do like the fact that they have actually sorted out the lighting on the heatsink, though, because some of the Z270 ones, like the Strixes, they didn't do, and I thought that was a big kind of they really missed out with it. Do you know what I mean? But there's lots and lots of good features on this board. It's definitely one to tweak with. I can assure you as well, from discussions that I've had with the Asus BIOS team, that things are going to progress quite rapidly. It's one of the ones I'm a little bit more comfortable with, is knowing that there is stuff coming, and I have spoken to him about volts, and and they're talking about the VID and the offset, all that sort of thing, and they will find ways around it, but they're working to an unbelievable schedule trying to get this even ready in the first place. Talking about ready, people are already starting to hype up with, where are they all? And that's across all brands as well. There just wasn't a lot at stock, a lot at launch. Now, I did hear that there wasn't very many chipsets, but at the same time, I don't know whether they're all kind of like running around like headless chickens, trying to get stuff fixed before they actually, pummel the market with stock, because it has been incredibly limited. But then again, so is memory support. And, the driver, the BIOS has been coming out thick and fast as well. So if you do manage to get hold of one early and you don't quite get what you're expecting, then just remember to keep your eye on BIOS. I've also seen a lot of people straight away going, oh my God, it's stock, it's 56 gigahertz. You would be happy if it was 56 gigahertz. We wouldn't be having any problems. It's 56 degrees. They are hot. It's not the boards, it's the actual chip itself. So what you need to do is you're going to need to set manual volts. You're going to need to make sure you've got decent cooling. There are a lot of things you have to kind of almost forget what you've got used to in the past and treat this as a new thing and go into it with a clear piece of paper and work out things going forward, rather than going in with pre-expectations based on older Intel platforms and then expecting it to work exactly the same with this. This is a brand new product and we have to treat it as such. And there are teething problems at the moment, but I can assure you, especially Asus, because I've been in contact with them a lot over the last week or so, they are working night and day to get stuff done. And the difference between this board, when I first got sent it at launch, and now, is night and day. There's so many little tweaks and changes and more stability already, and I know where it's heading as well with the things that they're trying to work on at the moment. So we know memory compatibility will get better. That is a prime focus, but that has to be done by AMD. So really we need to be giving them a knee in the gonads and getting them on with it. And then the rest of it should kind of follow suit. But anyway, it's a cracking board. It's definitely one that if you want to play with it, it's not one for those of you that are going to moan about the price. If you do moan about the price and you're just like, I just want a game, then go and buy one of the cheaper ones and you'll be absolutely fine. Because the one thing I will say is if that's the type of person that you are and you're not interested in the BIOS, then you definitely will not ever get your money's worth out of this board. This board is for those of you that want to tweak and play and have a laugh and overclock and try different memory and overclock your memory, because with this you kind of can do, whereas with the Z270 chipset and stuff on the Intel platform you kind of couldn't, because that was all a bit locked down because of base clock and all that sort of stuff. So with this you do have stuff to play with. This is the board that you pull your Ethernet cable out the back of your rig, so that you're not constantly signing into Skype and Discord and all that sort of stuff. You pull your Ethernet cable out the back and you spend your evening on a Friday night literally just going in and out of the BIOS, running benchmarks, trying to get your rig to run quicker. It's an enthusiast product, and it's a product for enthusiasts, and that's why it got the Enthusiast Award. I couldn't have said enthusiast anymore. And I know I'm going to get asked, so the keyboard is the Claymore and then the mouse is the Spartha. They're both Asus ones. They will all kind of link up with the RGB-ness and everything. I've just not got round to that. But anyway, be quiet, Tom. There was lots of chat. Hopefully there was lots of information. I would love to hear your feedback about it underneath. But if you'd like to discuss the review, you can go to the OC3D website and forums as well. And if you are thinking about buying it, I would urge you to go and look at the other graphs on the OC3D forums. Anyway, if this is the first of my very lengthy, chatty, lots of information videos you found and you liked it, hit the subscribe button, wherever that might be. Anyway, this is Tiny Tom Logan with another video for you, quite weirdly looking at himself, wandering around, because I don't normally do this, out.